Hey guys, Professor Dave here. Today I want to talk to you about nucleophilic substitution, specifically the SN2 reaction.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So for any substitution reaction, one atom or group is being replaced by another atom or group. So let's take a look at this generalized SN2 here. And so that's exactly what we're seeing. We've got a hydroxide ion replacing a chloro group on this molecule. So for any SN2 reaction, we want to identify three key players. So the first is the nucleophile. The nucleophile is something that has excess electron density. So this could be a formally negatively charged atom or polyatomic ion, or it could be something with a lone pair. Basically, anything with excess electron density, like a hydroxide ion, that's got a formal negative charge. Then there's always going to be an electrophile. So this is just the opposite. This is something with electron deficiency. So here, this carbon atom is acting as the electrophile because of the polarity of this bond. So we all know that chlorine is more electronegative than carbon. Therefore, this is a polar covalent bond, meaning the electrons in that bond are being hogged a little bit more by chlorine, leaving a partial positive charge on that carbon. So a formal negative charge is going to be attracted to a partial positive charge. And then lastly, every SN2 is going to have a leaving group, because the only way that this carbon can accept a bond from an incoming nucleophile is if it then loses a bond to some other atom or group, right? Because carbon can only have four bonds. And so the chlorine is the leaving group here. And so when the hydroxide attacks, the chlorine will leave. And at the end, we have methanol and a chloride ion. Okay, now that we know what's going on in an SN2 reaction, let's take a closer look at the mechanism. So for one thing, whenever we're drawing mechanisms for organic reactions, we have to be very careful with our electron pushing arrows. These are arrows that depict the direction of electron flow, and they have to be drawn in a very specific way. So we're always going to go from electron rich to electron poor. So this first arrow goes from the oxygen atom, because that's the oxygen rich atom, that's the one with the negative charge. So the arrow starts there and is going to go directly to the carbon atom, because that is the electron deficient site. That's where there's the partial positive charge. This arrow is going to originate in the center of this bond, meaning that the two electrons in that covalent bond are going to leave with the chlorine atom, leaving the chloride ion. So the electron arrows must be drawn in a very specific way, and so watch that on your exams. That's an easy place to lose a lot of points. So let's take a look at some other aspects of the SN2 reaction. So this is an sp3 hybridized carbon with tetrahedral geometry, right? There's four electron domains, so these are 109.5 degree bond angles. Now, for the SN2 reaction, there has to be a backside attack for the nucleophile, meaning for any reaction, the highest occupied molecular orbital of what is doing the attacking is going to dump electrons into the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital of whatever is acting as the electrophile. So here, on this substrate, the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital is 180 degrees from this carbon-chlorine bond. So here's the leaving group. That means that the nucleophile is going to have to attack precisely 180 degrees from there. So it is always going to go this way. And then for any step in any reaction, we can always look at something called the transition state. So that's this. Now, as this approaches, so basically, this is all happening in one step. The key with the SN2 reaction is that it is a one-step reaction for nucleophilic substitution. So it's a legitimate question to wonder why it's called SN2, even though it's one step. So the 2 does not refer to the number of steps. 2 refers to the fact that it is a bimolecular transition state, meaning that the substrate is coordinated loosely both to the nucleophile and the leaving group simultaneously in the transition state. So basically, we can see a partial covalent bond beginning to form between the oxygen and the carbon, and a partial bond here between the carbon and the chlorine as the chlorine begins to leave. So you can think of it almost as like a half bond each in the transition state. Now, the interesting thing happening in terms of geometry is that In SN2, the substrate is going to sort of invert like an umbrella. So we can see here that we have one orientation, but then as this electron density from the nucleophile approaches, this is going to start to invert like that until we have this trigonal bipyramidal-like transition state here because of the 5 electron domains. And then as the bond materializes between the oxygen and the carbon, the chlorine leaves, we return to sp3 tetrahedral geometry, but we do have an inversion at that center. So if SN2 occurs at a chiral center, it will necessarily invert the stereochemistry there. So if it was R, the product will be S, or vice versa. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.